Aye.
All right. God's good, amen.
Amen.
Let's open our Bibles, make our confession this morning, say it like you mean it, and like you said.
This
is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
And I have what it says I have. And I can be what it says I can be.
I can be what it says I can be.
And I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says I can do.
My mind is alert.
My mind is alert.
My heart is receptive.
My heart is receptive.
I'm a winner.
I'm a winner.
I'm a whiner.
I'm a whiner.
I'm a doer.
I'm a doer.
I'm not just a hearer.
I'm not just a hearer.
I said I'm a doer.
I'm a doer.
I'm not just a hearer.
I'm just a hearer.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I was up all the time, body of Christ. So turn to somebody pointing behind you next to you and say, thank God, you brought the rest of my body. Appreciate it.
God loves you, and so do I.
Turn to somebody and say, God loves you, and so do I. This morning, I want you to turn to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. We'll start at verse 30. As you turn there, the Bible says, a mere heart doeth good like medicine, so I got you a little medicine this morning. Remember, these are just humorous stories, so please don't be offended. John chapter 8, verse 30. Brenda hurried to the pharmacy to pick up some medication. When she got back to the car, she found her keys locked inside. She found an old rusty coat hanger on the ground. She looked at it and said, I don't know how to use this. So she bowed her head and she asked God to send her some help. Within 5 minutes, an old motorcycle pulled up, driven by a bearded man who was wearing an old biker skull rag. He got off his cycle and asked if he could help. She said, yeah, my husband's sick, and I've locked my keys in my car. I must get home. Please, can you use this hanger to unlock my car? He said, sure. He walked over the car, and less than a minute, the car was open. She hugged the man, and through tears, said, thank you, God, for sending me such a very nice man. The man heard her little prayer and replied, lady, I'm not a nice man. I just got out of prison yesterday. I was in prison for car theft. She hugged him again, sobbing, said, oh, thank you, God. You even sent me a professional. Forrest Gump is at the pearly gates. However, the gates are closed, and Forrest approaches the gatekeeper. The gatekeeper said, well, Forrest, it is certainly good to see you. We have heard a lot about you. I must tell you, though, that this place is filling up fast, and we've been administering an entrance examination for everyone. The test is short, but you have to pass it before you can get into heaven. Forrest responds, it sure is good to be here, sir, but nobody ever told me about any entrance exam. I sure hope the test ain't hard. Life was a big enough test as it was. The gatekeeper continued, yes, I know, Forrest, but the test is only 3 questions. First, what 2 days of the week begin with the letter T? Second, how many seconds are there in a year? And third, what is God's first name? Forrest leaves to think the question over. He returns the next day and sees St. Peter, who weighs him up and says, now that you've had a chance to think the questions over, tell me your answers. Forrest replied, well, the first one, which 2 days in the week begins with the letter T? Shucks, that would be today and tomorrow. The gatekeeper's eyes opened wide and he exclaimed, Forrest, that's not what I was thinking, but you do have a point. And I guess I did not specify, so I'll give you credit for an answer. How about the next one? How many seconds in a year? Now that one's harder, replied Forrest, but I thunk and I thunk about it. I guess the only answer I have would be 12. Astounded, the gatekeeper said, 12? Forrest, how in heaven's name could you come up with 12 seconds in a year? Forrest replied, shuck, there's got to be 12. January 2nd, February 2nd, March 2nd.
Love this man.
Ho, hold it, he interrupts the gatekeeper. I see where you're going with this, and I see your point, though that was not quite what I had in mind. But I'll have to give you credit for that one, too. Let us go on with the third and final question. Can you tell me God's first name? Sure, Forrest replied. It's Andy. Andy? The frustrated gatekeeper said, okay, I can understand how you come up with the answer to my earlier question, but just how in the world did you come up with the name Andy as the first name of God? Shucks, that was the easiest one of all, Forrest replied. I learned it from the song. Andy walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I'm his own. And the gatekeeper opened the pearly gates and said, run, Forrest, run. Okay, here's a good one. Betty got home from the funeral of her husband. She had had him cremated. She took the urn containing his ashes and she spread it all over the living room floor. She said, Don, this is all about promises. Remember the dishwasher you were going to buy me? Well, I bought it with insurance money. Remember the new car you were going to buy me? Well, I got that with the insurance money, too. And remember the new, big, beautiful diamond ring that you were always going to buy me? Well, I got that, maybe a little bit bigger, with the insurance money. And then she runs her fingers through the ashes and says, remember the new vacuum cleaner you were going to buy me? Well, I got that, too, and here it comes. Praise God. John chapter 8, verse 30. As he spake these words, many believed on him. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That little word, if, is a big word. That means we have something to do. We have a responsibility. He says, if you do your part, my word's going to do its part. He says, you're going to know the truth. Truth about every area of your life. And he said, my truth will make. How does it make it? As you listen to the word and as you apply the word, then the word will make you free. It's a process, church. So many times we come to church, we want a little quick prayer, a little dab will do you. Let somebody lay hands on us, pray us, and everything's going to be okay. No, there are things in our life that we're going to have to learn from God's word. And then we're going to have to apply it in our lives to get the results that God says we can have. And it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Amen? As Christians, we know without taking in God's word, our faith will become anemic, shallow, and weak. The Living Translation says it this way. Then many of the Jewish leaders who heard him say these things began believing him to be the Messiah. And Jesus said to them, you are truly my disciples if you live as I tell you to, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
There's a lot of people out there say, I'm a Christian. Mm-hmm. I'm a follower of God. But his word says, if you do what I tell you to,
yes.
Then are you my disciples. That's what separates the men from the boys. Amen?
Amen.
Are you a doer? We tell that confession. I'm a doer and not just a hearer. Are we really doers of the word of God? Amen?
Yes.
But so many times we neglect the precious gift of God's word in our daily lives. So many times we're going through things and we're looking for answers. We're looking for answers in all the wrong places. We'll go over here and tell somebody our problems. Well, I know they went through this. I'm telling them my problems and see what kind of input I can get back from them. And all they can tell you is what they've experienced.
Uh-huh.
You ever been facing surgery? And you find somebody that had the same kind of surgery you had, and you begin to tell them about your surgery. Oh, yeah, I got a scar from here to here. That don't make you feel a whole lot better, does it? And what I'm going to talk to you about today is just a simple list to help us motivate our souls when we tend to wander. A list about giving ourselves to the Word of God in 2017. And a reason for every month that you might be willing to give up.
Yes.
Okay? And first I'm going to read this little story to you, because I want this to stay in your mind while I'm talking. Imagine a caterpillar that spends its life trying to be the prettiest, most popular caterpillar around, or trying to be the most successful by gaining money and caterpillar riches. The point of the caterpillar's existence isn't to become beautiful, popular, or successful as a caterpillar. It is to die as a caterpillar and to be born as a butterfly. So with us, you're not on this planet to look the prettiest, become the most popular, successful, or wealthy. This whole life is a caterpillar life. You're here to exchange it for a butterfly's life.
Yes.
To die to the old life so that you can live the greater life.
Amen.
That means letting go of this caterpillar life, dying to self, the flesh, to ego, dying to the caterpillar life, giving instead of taking, letting go and decreasing.
Yes.
Don't lose sight of why you're here. This is what it's all about. Don't get caught up in the caterpillar stuff. Look beyond, press beyond, let go of that caterpillar life, enter into the realm of the butterfly so that you can become that beautiful heavenly creature that God calls you to become in Jesus Christ. Amen. So many of us, we're trying to live the caterpillar life. And God said, I've got something better for you. Amen. But as you know, when a caterpillar's coming out of his cocoon, there's a struggle. You ever seen one trying to come out of his cocoon and you reach over and try to help it? You tear the cocoon open and the caterpillar comes out and wings does not develop because it did not have the struggle. And therefore cannot fly, cannot be that beautiful butterfly. But it's the struggle that's in the cocoon that's going from the caterpillar to the butterfly.
Yes.
Church, sometimes we want to be the butterfly, but we don't want the struggle. Amen?
Yes.
The number one point, the Bible enables us to know and love Jesus more. John 5:39, you write that scripture down. John 5:39. You search the scripture because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it's they that bear witness about me, about Jesus. You see, the Bible is not the ultimate. Jesus, the Word of God, is the ultimate. But the Bible is a place where we know for certain that we can see and know our Savior every day.
Amen.
You're not going to get to know Him if you don't spend time in this. Okay? You're not going to know who you are in Christ if you do not spend time in this.
Amen.
If you go to court and you don't know what your rights are, the lawyers and the judges can do anything they want to because you don't know who you are, you know what your rights are.
Amen.
Well, the same way with the devil. The devil can do anything in our lives because we don't know who we are. We don't know what our rights are. We don't know what power and what authority we have. You've got to read the Word of God. He said, faith comes by hearing and by hearing the Word of God.
Amen.
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 The Old Testament writings promise him and point toward him. This is what blew my mind. The scribes and the Pharisees at the time when Jesus came to this earth, he fulfilled everything that they had known about him, everything had been taught about him, and yet they were still blinded and couldn't see him. The Gospels show us his ministry here on earth, leading to his death and his resurrection. The letters show us the work he continues to do by his Spirit through his church, which is the body. How many know God's still working on the body?
Amen.
How many thankful that he's still working on the body?
Amen.
Amen? See, the world out there thinks the moment you've got to be a Christian, you became perfect. Boy, you ask your wife or your husband, they can tell you right quick, that ain't true. Amen? You're not perfect, you're just forgiven.
Amen.
That means you're striving to be all that God wants you to be more and more like him. But you're going to make mistakes. You're going to fall short sometimes.
Yes.
You're going to do the wrong thing sometime. Even when you do the wrong thing, you're in good company. You know why? Because Paul said, the things I want to do, I don't do. And the things I want to do, I don't find myself doing them. And he wrote the majority of the New Testament. That means I'm in good company. Man, if he can mess up, that means I can mess up. But he said, how am I ever going to overcome it? Through Jesus Christ. Church, he's the only hope we have of ever having what the Word says we can have. Amen? You and I cannot be good enough to please God. This is what's wrong with a lot of the church. They think, well, and a lot of people say, well, I just can't serve God because I can never be good enough. None of us can be good enough. It takes Jesus Christ. It's not our righteousness. It's not what we do. All we need to do is believe in Him.
Amen.
It's what He did and what He's doing in our life. Most of us, we've been on a diet before, huh? And you start out and you're really sincere. And you're, man, the first day or two, boy, you're really gung-ho. A week or two later, all of a sudden, you find yourself eating more than you should eat. All the weight you lost, you find you gained it back. That's the way we are when we try to be good enough. Then all of a sudden, we get discouraged because we can't be good enough. And then we just want to walk away from God. Well, I tried it just don't work. It works for everybody else, but it can't work for me. Church, none of us. There wasn't but one that was good enough. That was Jesus Christ. None of us. None of us will ever measure up in our own righteousness. We are the righteousness of God. When the devil tells you how unworthy you are and how you don't measure up and you just can't make it, you're not good enough. Begin to tell him, it doesn't matter what you say, what matters is what God says. And God says, I'm the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
There is nothing and no one more valuable for you to know and to love in 2017 than Jesus. And there's nowhere you're more likely to encounter him than in this book. Number two, the Bible gives us hope in God no matter what is happening in our lives. Whatever was written, Romans 15:4, you can write that scripture down. Romans 15:4. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction. Tell somebody he's talking to you. That through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. The Bible is the foundation under our feet that gives us the encouragement we need to remain hopeful in Christ through times of depression and suffering. I don't know how people make it who don't know God. Because you can only take so many sedatives and so many tranquilizers and drink so much stuff and take so many drugs and it still ain't going to change anything.
Amen. That's right.
How do you live without hope in God? How do you get up every morning knowing this is all there is? When you're going through the tough times, that's why you've got the scriptures. You go back and you read it. And you see some of these people in the Bible. They went through some tough times. We can have been telling, well, I got saved. Jesus on my side, so everything's going to be perfect. Wow, wake up call. You enlisted in God's army, and you just come out of the devil's army, and he wants to get you back in his army. Amen? We have a God who wrote a book so that we might be people with hope.
Yes.
And we need to take advantage of the precious gift. Sometimes we've got to go blow the dust off our Bibles.
Amen.
And we wonder why our lives are in such bad shape because look what kind of shape our Bible's in. You can always tell somebody that's really walking with God, look at their Bible. That thing's about half wore out. You know they've been using that thing. Amen?
Yes.
God left us as a gift. You've heard the old saying, the Bible, B-I-B-L-E, basic instruction before leaving earth.
Amen.
Some of us, we never open the instruction book. It's kind of like some of us men, you know, when we want to put stuff together, our wife says, here, you want to read the instruction? Oh, no, I got it.
Come on.
I got it.
Okay.
No problem.
All right, just saying.
Then all of a sudden you're left with all these screws and nuts and washers and you think,
come on.
Didn't need him anyway.
Yeah.
That's the way we do with God.
Oh, amen.
We're trying to figure out how to live this life, but yet we're not going to the instruction book. We're depending on what somebody else told us. Church, you've heard me tell you this ever since I've opened this church. Never take my word or any other minister's word for it. You go to the Bible and you check it out for yourself. This is your eternal salvation we're talking about. You don't need somebody's opinion. You need the truth. He said the truth is going to make you free. Amen. Number three, the Bible leads us to supreme happiness in God. Psalms 1, verses 1 and 2 says, blessed, this means happy, is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night.
Yes. Yes.
Psalms 1, verses 1 and 2. God revealed himself in his word, church. And if we're going to discover the path that leads to the fullness of joy and pleasures evermore, according to Psalm 16, verse 11, then you've got to get into the Bible.
Yes,
don't listen to what everybody else says.
Amen.
Don't listen to somebody else's experience.
That's right.
Oh, I tried to serve God and all those hypocrites in there. Man, there's no way I could. Got news for you. Amen. Those hypocrites are closer to God than you are because they're standing between you and God.
Amen.
Throw this in just while I'm on a rabbit trail anyway.
Come on.
What most people call hypocrites are just people that are struggling with everyday life, trying to live this life and trying to walk this thing with God. And because they mess up, because they fall short, because they still live in this flesh and there's a warfare going on but inside of them and they make mistakes, we think, oh, they're a hypocrite. No, they're struggling with something. They're working on something. God's still dealing with them. And don't get me wrong, there are hypocrites out there. There's people who know what they're doing and intentionally do it. But someone who's struggling, someone who's trying, someone who's striving, God is helping that person. Amen. The happiness of the Bible offers us is as unchanging and as durable as the God who wrote it. And he himself is the greatest treasure, church, that we have. Amen. Number four, the Bible arms us to kill our sin by the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Romans 8:13 says, if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live.
Yes.
He says, you've got to put it to death.
Yes, you have.
This is your temple. This is your house.
Come on. Amen.
What do you allow and what do you not allow?
Yep. Come on.
The devil can't force it on you. God's not going to make you do it. You have a choice every day of your life.
Yes,
you've got to get up and you've got to deny what the flesh says and do what the Spirit says.
Amen.
You heard me say this so many times. Whichever one you feed the most, that's the one that's going to win.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good.
Ephesians 6:17 says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
You use the Word of the God, Word of God, church. In the hands of the Spirit of God to hack up the sin in our life that keeps us from God.
Yes.
The sword pierces through the bone and marrow to reveal our hearts.
Amen.
The Bible says your own heart will deceive you.
Yes.
You know, there's a lot of people that are going to, and I hate to say this, but it's sad, but there's a lot of people going to end up in hell and they're going to go and they're going to think they're okay. I'm a good person. Good people go to hell.
Yes.
Saved people go to heaven. No way to the Father except through the Son.
Yes,
amen?
Amen?
No remission of sin unless the blood is shed.
Amen.
The wages of death, the wages of sin is death.
Yes.
In other words, there's a payday coming, church. We might be getting away with it right now, but there's a payday coming.
Yes.
Not to mention, whatever we're doing right now, we're opening doors for the devil either coming to kill, steal, and destroy, or we're opening doors for God to come in and give us an abundant life. It's our choice. With sin removed and cleansed, church, we can see Christ more fully. Sometimes we can't see God because of all the garbage that's in our life. And God wants to move all that out of the way so you can see Him. How many of you have ever seen that movie Avatar?
Yes.
What'd they say? I see you.
Yes. Come on.
I see you.
I see you.
Church, some of us, we need to see him.
Yes, amen.
We don't need to walk off somebody else's experiences. We need to see God for ourselves. We need to recognize him for ourselves. We need to hear him for ourselves. You say, well, God don't talk to me. Yes, he does. You may be on AM, him on FM, but he talks to you. Amen.
Come on.
Number five. In the Bible, we hear directly from the mouth of God of the universe. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is breathed out by God. May we never be bored reading the Bible. May we never forget the Almighty God of the universe is speaking directly to us in those moments. Church, this is just not a book. This is the living Word of God. When you go into the book, you should go with an expectation that I'm going to hear from God. God is going to speak to me. How many times have you read a certain scripture in there and you've been going through something and you read that same scripture again and all of a sudden a light bulb goes off and think, I never saw that before. God is speaking to you. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. You know, there's probably people you'd just die to meet in person. And you'd never miss the opportunity if it was given to you. You would clear your schedule of anything you had to just to be with them. Shouldn't the God of the universe make that list?
Yes.
We meet him again and again in his word when we read the Bible.
Yes,
I've heard people, oh, I want to know God. Get in the word. Spend some time with him. Can you imagine if Joy and I had gotten married and I'd never spent any time with her, I never communicated with her, what kind of relationship we would have had? Some of us, we do the same thing to God. We get saved and we think, well, that's all it is. I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, that's all I need. No. You need to know how to walk and live in this life. You need to know how to become more and more like him. Stop and think about it. God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, takes time out of his busy schedule just to communicate with you and I. I had a lady one time pray for me. I was going through some things. And as she was praying for me, she said, God is weeping over your situation. Man, that made me feel so important. God Almighty is concerned about me?
Amen.
Sometimes we forget that. Number six, the Bible is a free course of life taught by God himself. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is profitable for teaching. If God is speaking and his word is profitable for teaching, then we get to go to class every day under the professorship of God himself.
Yes.
And it's free. God has given us his spirit to teach us his secret and his hidden wisdom. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians. Y'all receiving this morning?
Amen. Amen.
1 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm going to start at verse 1 because I'm going to read this whole thing.
Amen.
I'm going to read it in the Living Translation. It says, dear brothers, when I first came to you, I didn't use lofty words and brilliant ideas to tell you God's message. Now, I want you to keep in mind, Paul was taught under the most intelligent scholars of that time. Okay? For I decided that I would speak only of Jesus Christ and his death on the cross. I came to you in weakness, timid and trembling. And my preaching was very plain, not with a lot of oratory and human wisdom. But the Holy Spirit's power was in my words, proving to those who heard them that the message was from God. I did this because I wanted your faith to stand firmly upon God, not on man's great ideas. Yet when I'm among mature Christians, I do speak with words of great wisdom. But not the kind that comes from here on earth, and not the kind that appeals to the great men of this world who are doomed to fall. Our words are wise because they are from God, telling of God's wise plan to bring us into the glories of heaven. This plan was hidden in former times, though it was made for our benefit before the world began. But the great men of the world have not understood it. If they had, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory. Yes. Verse 9. That is what is meant by the scriptures which say that no mere man has ever seen, heard, or even imagined what wonderful things God has ready for those who love the Lord. But we know about these things because God has sent His Spirit to tell us. And His Spirit searches out and shows us all of God's deepest secrets. No one can really know what anyone else is thinking or what he's really like except that person himself. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own Spirit. And God has actually given us His Spirit, not the world's Spirit, to tell us about the wonderful free gifts of grace and blessing that God has given us. In telling you about these gifts, we have even used the very words given to us by the Holy Spirit. Not words that we as men might choose, so we use the Holy Spirit's words to explain the Holy Spirit's facts. But the man who isn't a Christian can't understand and can't accept these thoughts from God, which the Holy Spirit teaches us. They sound foolish to him because only those who have the Holy Spirit within them can understand what the Holy Spirit means.
Amen.
The things we're talking about here this morning, even you being here this morning, to most people in the world is foolishness. Why do you have to go to church? Why do you have to read your Bible? It's foolishness then. Because it's revealed by the Spirit and they're not born again, so therefore they don't have the Spirit of God to reveal these things to them. And Paul said, I didn't come to you with man's wisdom. He said, I came speaking what the Holy Spirit gave me to speak. You can be the most knowledgeable biblical scholar in the world, and you can know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, and you can be a great person that gives sermons out and all this thing going. But if you don't have the Holy Spirit backing it up, church, it's just words. It's the Spirit of God that makes it alive and living in our lives. It's the Spirit of God that gives us revelation and reveals God in His Word. Amen. You don't have to be a super educated or super intelligent person for God to use you.
Amen.
He says, I'll use the foolish things
to find the wise.
Oh, when I read the Bible and get enough of the Bible, I mean, I can do it. No, all you need is get as much Jesus as you can get in you. Amen.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit. When I first read the Bible, it didn't make any sense to me. All these these and thous and symbolism didn't make any sense. But as the Holy Spirit began revealing things to you, and you begin to see beyond what God's saying, you begin to see the things, deeper things that God is saying. But without the Spirit of God, it's foolishness. Amen?
Amen.
Number 7. The Bible enlightens us to areas where we need to grow so that we can be changed and trained into the image of Christ. 2 Corinthians 3:18. We all with unveiled face beholding the glory of the Lord are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. As we see Jesus in His Word, we also see that we don't measure up. We will see sin in areas in our life that we need to grow. One thing about God, if you ask Him for something or you ask Him about something and pertaining to your life, get ready for the truth.
Come on. That's right.
He's not going to water it down. He's going to tell you the truth because it's the truth that's going to make you free. Amen?
Amen.
Sometimes when God tells us the truth, the Lord speaks to us and tells us something in our life that we need to give up or get rid of, or an area of our life that we need to grow in. And the Lord speaks to us, and what do? Get behind me, Satan. Because we don't want to hear the truth.
Come on.
Amen?
Amen.
Well, I know Stephen needs that, but I don't need that.
Come on.
Church, we learned that in the Garden of Eden.
Amen. Yes.
We did.
Amen. Sure did.
When God came to Adam, Adam said, it was that woman you gave me. When he went to the woman, it was the devil that made me do it. Amen.
Come on.
Jesus is the standard for change and the means of change, church.
Yes.
I'm not trying to grow up and be like Gary, and Gary's not trying to grow up and be like me. We're trying to grow up and be like Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
He's our measuring stick.
Yes,
He is. He's the one that's going to... He wouldn't tell us to change if He wouldn't give us the power and the authority to change.
Amen.
He's not going to tell us to do something we cannot do.
Right.
If He says an area in your life that needs to change, He's going to give you the power to change that.
Amen.
If you really, the Bible says you will find Him if you seek Him with your whole heart.
Amen.
Amen. As we see Him, the Spirit goes to work to change us more and more into His image. And to set us free, make us free from the little desires and idols that we've been settling for. You know, as a whole, the body of Christ settles for a lot less than what God wants us to have. And don't get me wrong now. When we think about things, we think about mansions and fancy cars and all that stuff. Those are all cool and good in their own time and season. But God wants to give you something much more precious than a mansion on a hill or a Cadillac to drive. He wants to give you peace in your heart. He wants to give you joy unspeakable. Amen? That no matter what's going on around about you, when everybody else is losing their cool, you still got it together because you know who you serve and you are fully persuaded that He can do what He has promised in your life. Amen? We go around sometimes saying, greater is He that's in me than he that's in the world. And we think about that scripture pertaining to overcoming the devil, having power over this. You know, the greatest application is, greater is He that's in me. That means He's given me the power. He's given me the authority. He's given me the right to change me. And it doesn't matter what happens out there. What's in me is greater than what's out there. I'll give you an example. When God let Satan do what He did to Job, He knew that what He put in Job was greater than what the devil was going to put on Job. Do you hear what I'm saying this morning? No matter what the devil is doing in your life, God trusts you and knows that He's got enough of Him in you that you're capable, you're well able to overcome whatever it is you're going through. Oh, but you don't know what I'm going through. It doesn't matter. God is God, church.
Amen.
There's nothing that He cannot do. I like this one. Number 8. The Bible equips us for good works that bring glory to our God. Again, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, all Scripture is breathed out by God, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. The Bible stirs us up. It equips us to do good works. And as we do these good works, others see them and they give glory to God in heaven.
Yeah.
1 Peter 2:12 says, we want our life to count for His glory. And God gives us the guide for that great cause in His Word.
Yes.
What we do is not to bring glory to us, it's to bring glory to Him. And sometimes if we be real honest with ourselves during the week, how we're acting and how we're talking and how we're treating other people, if we just be real with ourselves and ask, am what I'm doing and what I'm saying and how I'm acting, is it bringing glory to God? I'm wondering why I'm having troubles in my marriage. I'm wondering why I'm having trouble with my children. I'm wondering why I'm having trouble on the job. I'm wondering why I have trouble in my finances. I'm wondering why I'm having trouble in my health. Because we're not doing what God said to do.
Amen.
But if we'll do what God says to do, other people will look at your life and say, I don't know what you've got, but I want some of it.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
The sad thing is, kind of on the reverse, most people are looking at the church and they're saying, man, they're no different than what I am.
Come on.
Because the church has allowed the world to come into us and change us instead of allowing the Word to come in us and change us. Got quiet on that one, didn't it?
Amen.
Number 9. I want to go back to that. Whatever you do, let it bring glory to God.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Like Gary said a while ago, they didn't get up here to sing just for our applause. They got up here to bring glory to God.
Amen. Amen.
People need to see it in your life. You may be struggling, but they need to see the God in your life while you're going through the struggle.
Amen.
And then when you get through this, when you overcome this, they need to hear the testimony that you've got of what God's done in your life. Oh, I want a testimony, but I want no test. I want a victory, but I don't want no battle. I want to be an overcomer, but I don't want to have to overcome anything. No, it doesn't.
Amen.
Number 9, the Bible produces healthy, happy families and relationships. Ephesians 6, verses 1 and 4 says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord." We cannot know how and why we ought to obey our parents, at least in a way that honors God, if we do not know what the Word of God says. We cannot know how to raise our children to know and love and obey the Lord if we do not know what the Word of God says. You know, this is kind of a rapture total. Most men, this is the scripture that they remember in the Bible. Wives, submit yourself unto the husband. That means I walk tall, carry a big stick, and you do what I tell you to do. The sad thing is, they only take part of that scripture, amen? So for the husband is the head of the wife, even as the Christ is the head of the church, and he's the Savior of the body. Therefore, the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wife be unto the husband everything. Oh, I love that, man. She's got to do everything I tell her to do. Husband, love your wife, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it.
Come on now.
We don't like that part, do we? We like the authority thing. Yeah. No wife is going to have a problem submitting to a husband that loves her like Christ loves her.
Thank you. Amen. Amen.
Especially if he's willing to give himself for her.
Yes.
And that doesn't mean you have to go out there and die for him. That means you allow Christ to change you to where you can be the husband that her heart really wants you to be. And God wants you to be. Amen. I know I'm meddling over there. We'll get back to this, okay? Families and church families will be much healthier and happier places if we are people saturated with the Bible.
Amen.
Let this be your guide. You can't let it be your guide if you don't know what it says. You can't have faith for something you don't have knowledge of. Oh, I believe the Bible. Well, what part do you believe? Well, I don't know. I just believe the Bible. Well, when the devil comes against you, just say, "I believe the Bible." And you're going to say, "Oh, really? What part?" When Jesus came, when the devil came against Jesus, he didn't just say, "I believe the Bible." No, he said, "It's written." And then he told him what was written. And the devil couldn't do anything against what was written. Amen. Number 10. For those of churches over with, just bear with me. Okay? Number 10, the Bible keeps us from being conformed to this world. Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God and what is good, acceptable, and perfect." The world bombards us with foolish temptations, church. The world screams for conformity to its own systems and its ways. And we desperately need to be people who fix our eyes on Jesus and meditate on His words so that we are not conformed to this world, but transformed to be more like Him. Slap somebody and tell them, "I want to be like Him." What he's saying here is the world is trying to conform you from the outside in to be like the rest of the world. God's Word is trying to transform you from the inside out to be more like Him. And it's a choice you have to make. Amen? If you want to be average, ignore the word, and fall into the world. If you want to make an eternal difference for the world, be transformed by God's word. Remember the caterpillar and the butterfly?
Yes.
Number 11, the Bible teaches us to pray. If one turns away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is an abomination. Proverbs 28, verse 9. Without the Bible, our prayers too easily drift into our own fleshly, sin-driven complaints, desires, and pity parties. How many times when we get away from the Word of God and we go before God, it's all about, oh, doom, gloom, agony. Oh, Lord, I need you to help me. Amen?
Amen.
When we pray to God, we need to pray the answer, which is what the Bible says, and bring Him in remembrance of His Word. And when you get in agreement with His Word, then He works on that Word to perform it.
Yes. Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
He doesn't move because of your tears. He doesn't move because you're having a pity party.
No.
He doesn't move by your complaints.
No. Yes.
With the Bible, we can see reality. We can see our sin, even see the sins of others against us, and approach the throne of grace for help with the truth ringing in our ears. When I first met Joy, there were some people that was coming against us. And I would just tell her, don't worry about it. God's got it. Yeah, but you don't know. They're big. They're mean. They're this and this. Don't worry. God's got it.
He does.
God fights my battle.
Amen.
Amen.
Because I know that's what the Word says.
Yes.
He's my Father. He's my protection.
Come on.
He's my source.
Amen.
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 He's my defender.
Amen. Glory.
I don't have to fight my battles.
No.
I don't have to get even anymore.
No.
I don't have to pay somebody back for what they did to me.
Amen.
He said, everybody that blesses Abraham is going to be blessed. Those that curse Abraham is going to be cursed.
Amen.
Well, I'm Abraham's seed. You're Abraham's seed.
Yes. Amen.
That means whoever comes against you, they come against God. And God says, I'll take care of you. Most of us, we're all stubborn, especially us guys, we're stubborn. And when we was in the world, somebody do something to us, man, we're going to do worse to them.
Yeah.
They hurt us, we're going to hurt them twofold. Well, guess what? God has came and made you free from that. You don't have to do that.
Yes.
I don't know about you, I'd rather you do something to me than God do something to me.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
Number 12, the Bible spurs us toward genuine, healthy fellowship and accountability. Hebrews 10:24 says, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works.
Amen.
He said, let us consider how we can stir up one another in love and good works. The sad thing is the devil's come into the body of Christ. Instead of us stirring us each other to do good, we're out stirring each other up to get mad, point faults, criticize, backbite. Amen.
Amen.
And the world looks at that and says, I don't need none of that. I got that out here. What did Jesus say? He said, this shall show the whole world that you're my disciples. It's the love you show one to another. The world doesn't understand that, church.
No.
How can you love that person when they've done this and this and this and they're this kind of person? Look in your Bible. Jesus never turned his back on anybody. Religion will, Jesus Christ won't. Amen? I've told you this before. Before I got saved, I wouldn't like you and you wouldn't like me. Because I was too selfish, too hard-headed. But it took God coming into my life. It took God coming into your life. And now we're able to love each other beyond our faults. Beyond our shortcomings. I told y'all this before. You better start loving each other down here because you're going to spend eternity with them up there.
Amen.
You don't do it down here, you're going to be most miserable up there. The Bible helps us in our families and churches to make God's glory the goal. Sin, the enemy, and perseverance in our faith, the priority. I'm going to say that again. The Bible helps us in our families and churches to make God's glory the goal.
Yes, it does.
I'm not here today to bring glory to Roger. I'm here to bring glory to God.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yes.
You're here this morning not to bring glory to you, to bring glory to God. Everything you say, everything you do, you represent Jesus Christ. You're an ambassador, whether you like it or not. You carry the name Christian.
Amen.
Okay? May God's glory to the goal, send the enemy, and perseverance and our faith the priority. It's not going to be easy, but it's going to be possible.
Amen.
It gives us the courage and wisdom to humbly and lovingly admit our own wrongs to others and to confront sin in one another.
Amen.
That means if you've got Christ in your heart, then it's not hard for you to go to somebody and tell somebody, you know, I messed up. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have done this. I shouldn't have said this. I shouldn't have acted this way. Amen. And it says it also helps us confront sin in one another. Oh, I know what you've been doing.
Help me.
I know what you... No, that's not what he's talking about.
No, come on. No. Amen.
That means you're going to be the kind of person that I'm going to want to go to.
Yes.
And tell you my faults. Mm-hmm. And maybe the kind of person that somebody else can point out your shortcomings and your faults. And you're going to take it in the right attitude.
Amen.
And not get, well, who do you think you are?
Okay, come on.
I'm just trying to help.
Right.
Well, maybe you need to go homework on yourself first. And that may be true. But we do what the Word of God said. Would you rather somebody that's in your family point out the issue or somebody out in the world point out the issue?
Family.
Amen.
Friends. Really.
Closing, and we'll say this. Make this next year a journey to find joy in God by hearing from God. Because church, He's well worth it. Amen.
Amen.
You need to hear God for yourself.
Yes.
He'll speak to you in the Scriptures. He'll speak to you by the Holy Spirit. He'll even speak to you through other people. But you need to get to where you hear God for yourself.
Amen.
I'll read this one story and I'm closing, I promise. No Cowboys playing today, so y'all don't have to worry about that. This is called Great Presence. I cut it out of the paper yesterday. The 28th chapter of Genesis tells how Jacob, fleeing for his life after an exhausting day's journey, stopped and lay down to sleep. In his dreams, the Lord stood by him and made a promise. Know that I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. When Jacob awoke, he said aloud in awe, surely the Lord is in this place. I didn't even know it. In 1971, Denise and her close friend, Connie, enjoyed a trip together to London. Upon arriving at their hotel, they were informed that due to an unforeseen circumstance, their rooms were no longer available. However, the staff had arranged lodging for them in another hotel, the Queen's Gate. The Queen's Gate is one of the oldest and most historic hotels in London, but recently had been remodeled. The rooms, like most hotels in London, were very small with high ceilings. One of the things that made the rooms enjoyable was the acoustics in the rooms, and even in the hallways, a normal speaking voice reverberated with mellowness. As Denise and Connie stood with the key in hand before their fourth floor room, they were mesmerized by the elegant, strong voice of a man singing in his room at the end of the hall. Jokingly, they giggled at one another. Are we sharing the same floor with Pavarotti? Suddenly, the door at the end of the hall opened and a man put out his head and looked down the hall. Still giggling, but now embarrassed, they fumbled with their key, opened the door, and hurried in, escaping the man's gaze. A week later, they were back home in the U.S. in their separate home. One evening, it so happened that both had turned their TVs to a PBS special, The Three Tenors. At home and unfamiliar with the trio, Connie remarked to her husband, Bob, that man looks just like the man that Denise and I saw in London. Bob responded, that man is Luciano Pavarotti. Connie picked up the phone and called Denise. Do you know who it was that we saw in the hall at the Queen's Gate? They were in the presence of greatness and were unaware of it. Just imagine what could have taken place. An autograph, a handshake, an introduction, a visit. Who knows? Maybe a cup of tea. Oh, our hearts exclaimed, if we'd only been in their place. But the truth of the matter is that we are often in their place, in the presence of greatness beyond our fondest dreams. But we didn't expect it. We didn't recognize their greatness and so escaped God's gaze, God's visit, and God's blessing. In the hour of worship, in the silent moment of prayer, in the grandeur of nature, at the side of the hospital bed, in the guileless of children, at the burning bush of challenge, surely the Lord is in this place. Amen. Give God praise and glory. Amen. I hope y'all received this morning.
Amen.
I hope it encouraged you.
Yes, thank you.
God has got so much more for His church this year. I really believe, and I've heard a lot of preachers say it every year, but I really believe 2017 is going to be a very unique year for the body of Christ. Amen. Y'all stand, please.